Hello. This video will show a basic demo of using the BQ76942 evaluation board along with the BQStudio evaluation software. While this video will demonstrate the BQ76942, the procedure for the BQ76952 is identical. The only difference is that the BQ76952 works with up to 16 cells, while the BQ76942 works with up to 10 cells. Let's start by searching for the BQ76942 on ti.com. and then finding the BQ76942 product folder. Notice here the subscribe to updates button. This is very useful if you want to be notified of any future documents that are published for this device. Here we'll find the BQ76942 Evm user's guide. And for this demo, we will be focusing on the basic operation setup. Here we will want to connect a DC power supply. I'll be connecting a supply set to 35 volts from cell 10 to bat minus. I will have my jumpers installed to select I2C communication, and we'll have our USB cable connected. I also have cell simulator shunts installed. These provide a resistor divider from the power supply, so this will provide about 3.5 volts to each cell input. For this demo, I will also be connecting a second supply in order to simulate current across the sense resistor. Figure 16 in the Evm user's guide shows how to connect the second supply in order to simulate current. Let's take a quick look at the Evm schematic. This is available near the end of the user's guide. Here you can see the cells connect through the input filter resistors and capacitors to the VC0 to VC10 pins of the device. The Evm has a 1 milliohm sense resistor to measure the current. On the Evm, there are two different thermistors. One is connected to the TS1 pin, the other is connected to the TS3 pin. There are two LDO outputs, Reg1 and Reg2, and the Evm has many connectors to allow convenient access to signals. On page 2, there are jumper selections to select which communication format to use and whether to interface to the onboard EV2400 circuit or to an external microcontroller. By default, the device powers up in I2C mode, but it can be reconfigured for SPI or HDQ as well. There are additional external connectors for SPI and I2C. The cell simulator is a resistor divider that can be connected for evaluating the device when real cells are not connected to the board. This will apply an equal voltage across all cells. On this page, we show the path through the charge and discharge protection FETs. We can see our pre-charge and pre-discharge FETs as well. You can see that this board is normally populated with a series FET configuration, but it can be repopulated with components with a separate charge and discharge path. And finally, we have the onboard EV2400 circuit to help us communicate with the Evm from the PC. Next, let's talk about the evaluation software. The evaluation software we use to interact with the Evm is called Battery Management Studio, which is commonly referred to as BQStudio. When you go to the BQStudio product page, you will see there are two different versions of the software available. For the BQ76942 and 52, you will need to download the test version of BQStudio. The test version is the latest version and has support for the latest devices and the latest feature updates. If you happen to have an older version of BQStudio installed on your PC, you will need to first uninstall and delete the installation directory before installing the new version. Now let's open up the BQStudio software. As you first start to interact with the device using BQStudio, I recommend downloading the app note from the product folder called Easy Configuration of the BQ76942-52 Battery Monitors. The link for this app note is provided in the video description below. It walks through some of the basic settings for the device using BQStudio. As we first open BQStudio, there is a lot of information displayed on the screen. On the dashboard on the left, I see that it has detected the EV2400 interface controller, and it shows the EV2400 firmware version. It shows that the BQ76942 IC is detected, and it shows the firmware version of the IC. And it also shows the device is communicating with the interface controller using I2C. If I were to remove power from the device or remove one of the I2C jumpers, the dashboard will reflect that the device is no longer detected. If I were to disconnect the USB cable from my PC, the dashboard will reflect that the EV2400 controller is not detected. If the device is powered and all connections are okay, but BQStudio does not automatically detect the device, it could mean that the matching BQZ file for the device is missing from the BQStudio config directory. Before we get started, the first thing I recommend is to go to Window, Preferences, and there are two choices for the views. I recommend selecting Show Advanced Views. This gives you some more options for which registers are continuously updated or logged. In the Registers window, I can see the cell voltages displayed. The left panel also shows the total stack voltage and the current measured. Here you can see that the stack voltage, the pack pin voltage, and the voltage at the LD pin. Notice the units for these are in user volts. This is a programmable setting that is 10 millivolt units by default. So for example, the stack voltage is around 35 volts or 3500 centivolts. User volts can also be configured as millivolts, but this would exceed the maximum value of the registers since the max value is 2 to the 15th. That is, unless your application uses a lower number of cells that will keep the stack voltage below 32 volts. Another thing you will notice for the current is the units are in user amps. This is milliamps by default, but it can be configured to represent 0.1 milliamps, 10 milliamps, or 100 milliamp units, depending on the current magnitudes in the application. Many of the device commands are available as buttons on the right side of the screen, so the first thing I'm going to do is to enable the protection FETs. After I enable the FETs, I'm going to click Refresh, and we will see that the pack pin and LD pin voltages are starting to read much closer to the stack voltage value. The command window will show the command number and the result in the window below. The CC1, CC2, and CC3 current measurements are all shown. CC2 is updated very often, every 3 milliseconds or every 1.5 milliseconds, depending on the settings. CC1 is optimized for Coulomb counting and calculates the current every 250 milliseconds, and CC3 is highly configurable for even more resolution. There's the internal temperature sensor display, and right now, by default, the external TS1 temperature sensor is enabled. This value shows which cells are currently balancing, and none are balancing at the moment. This window shows the state of many of the status registers. Here, a red indicates the bit is high, and a green indicates a low value. It shows that the device is entering sleep mode when no current is detected, and the charge FET turns on and off as the device goes in and out of sleep. Clicking the scan button allows these values to be continuously updated. There's a parameter view button that will display even more registers, but we will just use the basic view in this demo. If I'm doing some experiments and I want to log the status of all the registers and measurements, I can click the Start Log button and choose a file name to start logging. When I'm finished, I can click Stop Log, and then I can open the file in Excel and see a record of all the registers over time. Another button to be aware of is the screen banner. This indicates the dashboard is on, so the PC will continuously read and check the connection status. By clicking on this, I can turn it off. This is sometimes recommended when performing experiments to remove additional traffic on the communication bus. Another useful feature is there are embedded tooltips. You can view the register descriptions by hovering the mouse over different registers. Next, let's go to the data memory screen. This is the RAM for the device and shows all of the device settings. The first set of parameters is the calibration values, and next is the basic settings. Let's go through some of the basic settings. First, I want to enable regulator 1. I want to set it as 3.3 volt output. So first I need to enable the pre-regulator, and then I want to set reg 1 to 3.3 volts. So I want to set these two bits, and then the enable bit. Now when you change the RAM settings in BQStudio, this happens automatically. But if you're using a microcontroller, there are two commands you need to use before changing a parameter. The first is set config update. After executing this command, the device is in config update mode and you can make changes to the RAM. And after you finish the changes, you execute the exit config update command. Like I said, BQStudio will automatically execute these commands as you make changes. If I want to set my alert pin to alert the MCU when a new measurement is available, or if there's a fault, I need to set its function to alert. Let's set it to use reg 1 and drive high when enabled. To decide what to report on the alert pin, I will use the default alarm mask register. Right now it is set to report multiple events by default, but I can also configure it to report when a new voltage and temperature measurements are available. I can use the Enabled Protections parameter to select which protections are enabled. Right now, we only have OV and SCD enabled. So maybe we can enable some of the other protections. Here, I can decide what the FETs will do in response to different faults. Right now, there is one pin set for temperature measurement. There is a second thermistor on the EVM, so I can go ahead and enable TS3 as well. If I want to reduce the number of cells in my application, 0 sets it to the default value of 10 cells. But if I wanted to set it to 9 cells, for example, I could configure it like this. All of these settings are stored in RAM, so if I power down the device and power it up, or if I execute the reset command, all of these parameters will be set back to default. In many applications, the MCU will configure the parameters on power-up. For some applications, it may be desired to have the settings programmed to OTP, which programs your settings as the new default settings. We can program OTP by clicking this button. First, we can check to see if OTP programming is possible. This checks the voltage and temperature conditions to make sure it is safe. We get an error that the voltage is too high. That is because the voltage for programming OTP should be between 10 and 12 volts. So if I set my supply lower to this range, I get a message that OTP programming is possible. This button will go ahead and actually program the settings to OTP. The OTP can only be programmed a small number of times, so if you have an EVM and you are unsure of your settings, it is probably best not to program OTP on the EVM because the device will be permanently changed. Once you have the settings you want, you can click Export and save this to a file. The normal file we use is in a gg.csv format. I will open this file in Excel to show. This file contains all of the device RAM settings and can be imported on BQStudio to another device. There are other export options that can be used for programming an MCU to set up the device. There are many other RAM settings like protections, where you can set the thresholds and delay for each of the protection parameters. We will not go over all of these. Next, I will show the calibration screen. I will set the voltage of my supply to exactly 35 volts so that I know that I have about 3500 millivolts on each cell and around 35 volts on the stack and pack and LD pins. Let's run voltage calibration and read the values now. We can do the same thing with the temperature. Assuming it is exactly 25°C in the room, I can calibrate internal temperature TS1 and TS3. If I want to calibrate current, I can start with zero current and calibrate the board offset. Now I will apply 500 milliamps of discharge current and calibrate the current gain. And now it is reading exactly 500. The next window is a little more advanced. BQStudio lets you push buttons to enable the FETs, but if you want to do that directly and you understand the protocol, you can go to the command sequence window. I recommend using the BQ76942 and 52 software development guide to guide you as you use this window. There are several examples available. That concludes the BQ76942 and 52 EVM demo. Thanks for watching. Be sure to visit the product page and subscribe to updates to be alerted when new device content becomes available.